What's up guys, it's Toby here and welcome to a brand new Transfer News video. And the main topic of this video is that Borussia Dortmund have tabled a 70 million euro bid for Sadio Mane, and we will discuss that in detail. But first, I want to hear your opinion on the Sadio Mane transfer situation. Would you accept around 62-63 million pounds bid from Dortmund for Sadio Mane? Do you want Liverpool to sell Mane? Do you think this season is the first part of his decline, or is it just an off season without fans during a pandemic and he caught the virus as well, so there are mitigating circumstances. I will be honest, I wouldn't sell Sadio Mane, but if the only way we can sign somebody like Erling Haaland or Kylian Mbappe by selling Sadio Mane, then that changes it, and I think then I would be maybe willing to sell Sadio Mane, because he is going to be 30 years old in 1 or 2 years, so it changes this, because Haaland or Mbappe is they are both generational talents, and if that's what it takes, then Liverpool need to evolve and make the next step. But first, I also want to hear your opinion on Jurgen Klopp saying that Manchester City wouldn't have won the league title if they had as many injuries as Liverpool. And basically he's saying that if Liverpool didn't have the three centre-backs out injured for more than half a season, Liverpool would have been champions this season. And we were top of the Premier League when Van Dijk and then Gomez and later Matip got injured. So I think it's a very interesting argument, and I want to hear your opinion on that in the comments below. And of course, if you enjoy these videos, leave a like and subscribe if you haven't already. So Jurgen Klopp said this: as good as Man City are, if they had three center halves out for more than half a season, no, they don't win the league title. Or if Man United had three center halves injured for like half a season or even more, no, they wouldn't have been able to win the title. I mean, Man United didn't have even one centre-back out injured for half a season, and they are not able to win the title. So imagine if Man United would have had their best three centre-backs out injured, they wouldn't even be in the top four probably. For the whole season pretty much, too, in the case of Van Dijk and Gomez. That is how it is, and Jurgen Klopp said, but the thing about this season is you cannot cut off the negative parts but the positive parts and say that we are nearly there. And Jurgen Klopp talked about this. I said when we lost our centre-backs, all of them pretty much, we broke our leg, but we could still win games. It was not always in the most convincing fashion, but we were still winning games and scoring. And then we had to at that time make midfielders into center halves, and it broke our spine. Then the whole setup was gone. The young boys were not ready to play at center half. The midfielders had to at times play at center half. And yes, that's the thing, you can't throw in very young players, rookie center backs, to play in the Premier League straight away. You had to put Fabinho, you had to put Henderson at center back, and you had to train the likes of Nat Phillips and Rhys Williams behind the scenes during the training grounds. You had to drill them, because playing center back for Liverpool in this specific system requires very specific tactical awareness, tactical understanding of what exactly is required and how to move as a unit for center backs. And that was incredibly difficult, and it took a few weeks or even a month or two, and that explains why Liverpool lost a lot of games. I think we lost some rhythm all of a sudden, but not all the time. A football team is like an orchestra where plenty of people work together, and if you lose one piece you might be able to still do it, but if you lose two pieces or three, then it becomes very difficult. It is how I said before, this year with the amount of injuries we have had, it was not the year to become champions, no chance. And that is the case for every team. If Man City had three centre-backs injured for the similar amount of time, they wouldn't have been champions. We have fought back a bit, Jurgen Klopp continued. The difficulties we accepted and made the best of it. And if we win on Sunday against Crystal Palace, and if we qualify for the Champions League, then we made the best of it, and that's it. Then move forward and look forward to next season. And I think fans being back at Anfield will be absolutely huge, and I cannot wait to watch the Liverpool-Crystal Palace game and cheer Liverpool on once again. And let's hope that we can beat Crystal Palace in Roy Hodgson's last game at Crystal Palace. It will be a tough game, but the Burnley game was a tough game, and we won that pretty comfortably in the end, 3-0. So let's hope that it's a good win for Liverpool. But it will be hard, it will not be comfortable, it will not be an easy win, and also it will be nail-biting stuff, because we will be watching the Leicester result, the Tottenham result, and the Chelsea result as well throughout the game. But what is also interesting is that Jurgen Klopp said that he won't tell the players the result in the other games, because he wants the players to focus on just the task at hand, which is beating Crystal Palace. He wants them to feel fully focused on the 90 minutes, and I think that's the right attitude, because if you hear that Chelsea are losing and Leicester are losing, and you take your foot off the gas and you don't win, and then they turn the game around in the last 5 minutes, what do you do then? You lose Champions League football. So I think it's best for the players to not know the result. But I think the fans will still know the result. They will be checking their phones or listening to the radio in the ground at Anfield. And probably the ground, the noise of the fans will tell the players something has gone well or not. And we will never know probably whether Liverpool would have won the Premier League title with a fully fit team. What we don't know, and Jurgen Klopp is fully 100% right in this, is that no other team would have won the Premier League title had they suffered a similar injury crisis to Liverpool. That's 100%. And according to TV2 Denmark, Liverpool have received a 70 million euro bid for Sadio Mane from none other than Borussia Dortmund, and Mane suffered a lot of critique for his perceived drop off in form this term, alongside struggling forward Firmino, even though Firmino has started scoring goals lately. And Mane hasn't made as strong an impact this season in front of goal, getting only 14 goals in all competitions, compared to 22 goals in our title-winning campaign last year. That isn't that big of a difference. The problem is that Sadio Mane scored a similar amount of goals in the first half of the season, but then he had a massive goal drought where he scored, I think, only one goal in something like 15 games, and that is unheard of, virtually unheard of in Sadio Mane's case. And he had a really, really big goal drought, and I think that's why many people were questioning Sadio Mane, because when Liverpool had this loss of form and we lost 6 home games in a row, basically, apart from Mo Salah, none of our forwards were scoring goals. So basically, since the end of January, when Mane scored in a 3-1 win away at Tottenham, he only has 4 goals to his name in like 3 months, 3.5 months. And that's just not good enough to score basically almost one goal every month. That's not good enough for a player of Sadio Mane's caliber, which means that basically in the first half of the season, Mane scored 10 goals or 9 goals if you don't count the Tottenham goal, and then for the second half of the season, he only scored 4 or 5, which is really not good enough. I'm still a big fan of Sadio Mane. I think next season, if he stays at Liverpool, he will come good. I would only sell Sadio Mane if there is a guarantee that with that money we can sign Erling Haaland or Kylian Mbappe, but the Mbappe transfer is a little bit more unlikely just because of the sheer amount of wages and the transfer fee that it would require. Erling Haaland would probably cost almost half as much as Kylian Mbappe, and they are similarly world-class players already with very high potential, and I think Erling Haaland would fit Liverpool a little bit better than Kylian Mbappe, just because of this sheer energy and relentless high pressing, and also his will to win, his relentless goal scoring machine that Erling Haaland is. He would really thrive at Liverpool. So that's the only way I would be okay with the Sadio Mane sale to Borussia Dortmund. That if we say to Dortmund, we will give you Sadio Mane, give us Erling Haaland, and maybe we pay another 30-40 million euros on top of your transfer fee for Sadio Mane, and then give us Erling Haaland. But I still think that Jurgen Klopp is a huge fan of Sadio Mane. He never forgets what Mane did for him, and he was involved in all the big trophies and all the great seasons that Liverpool had under Jurgen Klopp in the past 4 years or even 5 years. So I still think that Jurgen Klopp wouldn't sanction a sale of Sadio Mane, even if that meant Liverpool won't be able to sign Erling Haaland or Kylian Mbappe this summer. But that's just my opinion. Let me know if I'm right or wrong in this one. But also, there are some contrary reports to this, because Bundesliga journalist Chris Williams has refuted these claims that Borussia Dortmund are interested in Liverpool's Sadio Mane. He said, Borussia Dortmund are absolutely and unequivocally not tracking or are remotely interested in signing Sadio Mane for almost three times their current record transfer fee. So absolute nonsense was the confirmed response this evening to that report. They probably asked someone inside Borussia Dortmund, and Fabrizio Romano replied to this saying, correct as always. So make of that what you will, probably this rumor is not true according to this journalist and according to sources inside Borussia Dortmund. But then you might have to question, what do Liverpool do in this summer? Do they sell a lot of fringe players? Divock Origi, Sheldon Shaqiri, maybe Oxlade-Chamberlain, maybe even Naby Keita, because there are rumors that Naby Keita wants to sign for Atletico Madrid and they are interested in him, and we could sell him for around 25-30 million pounds. Would you sell Naby Keita if that meant the transfer budget will be boosted for the summer? I certainly would, even though I'm a huge fan of Naby Keita. I really, really think that Jurgen Klopp just doesn't fancy him anymore because he can't get an extended run of games in the Liverpool team, and that would be needed for Naby Keita to hit his top form. And Jurgen Klopp was asked about Ozan Kabak's future, and he said that Ozan Kabak was an incredible loan signing for Liverpool. He did it tremendously well. He's still just 21 years old, but he played with a lot of maturity and he did extremely well, especially against Leipzig, Jurgen Klopp said, but also in other games. And I think, reading between the lines, he basically can't confirm or deny whether Liverpool will sign him at the end of the season with the 18 million pound option to buy. Probably because he said basically that Liverpool have to wait until the season is finished, and we have to wait whether we will play Champions League football or Europa League football, because that will influence a lot of decisions. The finances will influence a lot of decisions whether Liverpool are able to sign Ozan Kabak plus Ibrahima Konate as well, because I think Liverpool want to sign Ibrahima Konate the most, and if we have money left over, we will sign Ozan Kabak on this 18 million pound option to buy clause that we have in his contract. But I think Jurgen Klopp is a big fan of Ozan Kabak. He said that he is a 21 years old center back, but he has a lot of experience. He already played for two of the biggest clubs in Germany, and also he played for one of the biggest clubs in Turkey and one of the biggest clubs in the world, Liverpool. And the Liverpool fans on fan forums agree. They said, I really hope Ozan Kabak stays. It would be an amazing Matip replacement. I would prefer it if he stays, another Liverpool fan said. He's better than Nat Phillips and Rhys Williams, plus the lad has more to give, bags of potential, and with Virgil van Dijk coming back, it would be better for him. And of course, Ozan Kabak loves Liverpool. He's a boyhood Liverpool fan and he wants to stay at Liverpool. He wants to play for us next season. And I think if we keep Ozan Kabak, plus we sign Konate, then our defensive options would be absolutely amazing next season, because then we would have Virgil van Dijk, Joe Gomez, Joel Matip, Ozan Kabak, and Konate and Nat Phillips as well. Imagine that center back pool of players. That would be absolutely out of this world, because I think Jurgen Klopp never wants to experience a similar scenario where we will have three center backs out injured and then we only can call on rookies. So I think we want to be on the safe side and have five center backs next season. And the players that I mentioned, these are actually six center backs, but you could argue that Nat Phillips and Kabak would be just insurance policies. And I mean, we could rotate the team. Basically, Van Dijk plays every big game and then we could partner him with whoever we want. And then in the Champions League, in the smaller Premier League games, we could have maybe Konate and Kabak, or Konate and Matip, whoever is fit and ready to go. Another Liverpool fan said, I would keep him unless we are going out spending huge money on another defender. Why not? I'm not gone on Gomez, to be honest. Matip is an injury-prone player. He actually hasn't looked that bad. Also, buying dirt from the German league is bollocks. Why not snatch one of Burnley's centre-backs? I mean, he's not dirt from the Bundesliga. Ozan Kabak is a much better centre-back with a much bigger potential than Burnley's centre-backs. I mean, Tarkowski is a good player, but would he play in a Liverpool system? No chance he would be able to. And I mean, yes, but not to the level of Ozan Kabak. That's just my opinion. And I also want to share what Paul Merson said about the Premier League's final day, and he said the final day will be full of drama and full of goals. The final day almost averages one more goal on average per game than the rest of the season, and I'm really, really looking forward to it. And this is what Paul Merson said about Liverpool. Liverpool are showing the form from the start of the season, and when they were top at Christmas, before it all drifted away, they are back to winning ways again, but without Virgil van Dijk, and you can see there is a swagger about them again. Against Burnley, they did not play great, and Burnley played well, but it just felt as though they were going to score goals. They went to Old Trafford and scored four, but if Crystal Palace turn up, and it is the final game of the season in front of Liverpool fans, they will cause Liverpool problems, as Burnley caused them enough problems the other night. And if you have got Wilfried Zaha and Christian Benteke, they could cause havoc. But it just depends on whether Crystal Palace turn up, and if Liverpool score an early goal. Palace have the ammunition, the strike force, to hurt Liverpool, but Liverpool have come so far, and it is in their hands. They have a cup final now. They have been pulling up trees to get there in recent weeks. It is a massive advantage having home fans. If there was no crowd in there, I would be not 100% sure. But with a crowd in, it's 100% that Liverpool are going to win, according to Paul Merson. I really hope that he is right. Liverpool's fullbacks will bomb on, and I'm sure Roy Hodgson will tell Zaha to stay up there and not worry about that. It is the last game of the season. Just go out and express yourselves, and that is when they can become very dangerous. 7 wins and 2 draws in Liverpool's last 9 league games. It is now a cup final, and if they get all the way to the final and blow it, that will be a nightmare for Liverpool. So I expect them to get the job done, but they need an early goal, as I do see Palace scoring, especially as Liverpool have to go for it. But I do expect Liverpool to win the game. They are not ripping it up, but they have found a bit of consistency. I saw them play Aston Villa at Anfield, and Aston Villa were much the better team, but they still won Liverpool, and we saw that at the end of last season when they were not playing well, but were winning football matches. And the name of the game is to make sure you are winning when you are not playing well, as I saw Liverpool losing games when they were not playing well earlier this season, but now they are grinding out results, and that's fantastic. And Paul Merson also said this, Leicester have to go out and win the game and then see where that takes them. It is a great game, as both Leicester and Tottenham have to win. A draw probably won't be any use to either team. Harry Kane will be going for the Golden Boot, and it may be his last game for Tottenham, so this will not be a walk in the park, and there is going to be drama. Leicester, Liverpool and Chelsea will not all be winning 3-0 at halftime. That is the way it happens on the final day. Tottenham were shocking in losing to Aston Villa in midweek, a Villa team you thought did not have much to play for. They scored early, and all of a sudden you think this is going to be a big win for them. And Aston Villa were far from their best. At the end of the day, if Leicester win and miss out on the top four on the final day for the second season in a row, that will be disappointing for them. But I see Leicester winning this game, Paul Merson said. And I mean, Tottenham really blew it, didn't they? They were leading 1-0 with a brilliant Bergwijn goal, his first goal since July of last year. And then Reguilón scores the most bizarre of own goals, and then Ollie Watkins scores another one. And before Tottenham knew it, what hit them, they were 2-1 down, and after that they could never get going in the second half. They really didn't create that many clear-cut chances. So Aston Villa will be dangerous, and Chelsea could be facing a potential banana skin, as they call it in England. And Paul Merson said, I think Chelsea have got the hardest game. This is the banana skin. Chelsea did play very well in midweek. They smothered Leicester, but they do not blow anybody away. And in the end, when Iheanacho scored, Chelsea's season was in danger of going up in flames. And that is Chelsea's problem. They can play amazingly against Aston Villa, and they will not blow them away and put the game to bed. And the longer the game goes and Chelsea are only winning 1-0, for example, all you need is a bit of magic from Saban, and all of a sudden it's 1-1 and you are out of the Champions League. And when you are not blowing teams away, scoring the second goal or third goal after going 1-0 up, panic can set in, and that is a dangerous game. Although I do think Chelsea will win, as they have got quality players, and the way Mason Mount is playing is unbelievable, but it will be a hard game, and Aston Villa are good defensively as well, but Chelsea are also very good defensively. So that is the final day preview from Paul Merson, and I think it's pretty well done, so I wanted to share that with you guys. I really hope that you guys enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching. Have a nice day. See you later, guys. Goodbye.